the Fringe meeting, today. It's obviously been an important and interesting conference in terms of Congress, I should say, in terms of the debates and the discussions and the motions that have been passed on the climate issues. I'm going to say just a few words myself and then introduce the platform and then just make some comments about our speakers, and some need to rush off before we close the meeting, so I'm just going to explain how we'll run the meeting. But I do want to say just a few words to start off with. It is clear from the events that have been happening most immediately and in the last year that climate change is not something that we need to worry about for the future. It's something that we need to worry about now. Very much now. I read a really nice, it's not a nice way of putting it, it's a nice way of doing these things. Bill McKibben, who some of you may know, is a leading climate activist in America, and he described it like this. He said, we're not having the side of the packet, we're not having the warning on the side of the packet stage, but we're having the hacking cough, which brings up the flood stage. And if we carry on doing this, we're going to be at a stage where, you know, it all comes to an end. And I think that's really important, because often these meetings talk about it as though it's a future issue rather than an issue that is real and live and affecting us now. Second point I want to make is, like all of the issues that have been discussed at TC Congress this week, and this is sometimes missed, I think, when we talk about climate politics. This is a class issue. This is an issue that affects working class people. Of course, it affects all people, but it is an issue that disproportionately affects the working class. It's an issue that disproportionately affects the poorest in the richest parts of the world. To read some of the reports about how people were preparing in America for the hurricanes, Hurricane Harvey, was to read the story of two countries, to read the story of the rich preparing for Hurricane Harvey and Irma with already hurricane-proof houses with glass that would withstand winds of 150, and then to read the story of the poor who were stranded with no place to go, clinging onto their homes because they couldn't move to any other part of the country. And of course it affects the poorest in the poorest parts of the world. And it's also a class issue because of the causes, because it's about the prioritisation of profit above the interests of people and the planet that we live upon. A couple of final points. With the right-wing populists that we've seen winning support, the Trumps of this world, have tried to present climate change in the following way. And by the way, the great ironies that you have Trump, the president that has refused to accept climate change, presiding over the most devastating impacts of a warming planet in the first few months of his presidency, the most horrible and devastating irony. But he presents climate change like this. He did do on the campaign trail, and continues to do it despite the reality of it, as something that to do with the liberal elite. It's a concern of the liberal elite, people who are disconnected from working class people. And it's framed, he has framed it in terms of good jobs versus the environment. If you want good jobs, you ignore the question of the environment. And it's something that can gain traction. It's something that has gained traction in areas of high unemployment with the possibility of no good jobs, or appears the possibility of no good jobs. And we have to say that it is a false narrative, that there isn't an alternative between jobs and the climate, that we can look after the climate and create the kind of jobs that put people into work. So, there are no jobs on a dead planet. Welcome very much to those people who have come today for the debate that took place at Congress. And I do want to finish by saying that trade unions have to be in the forefront of presenting that alternative, the alternative to jobs versus the environment, and challenging, not defending, the forces which are an obstacle to tackling climate change. Our speakers today, thank you so much for coming along. I want to give apologies for Barry Gardner, who unfortunately has to stay in Parliament. He hasn't been given HIPS permission to leave tonight, so he's not with us. I know he supports what we're doing, and we look forward to working with Barry in the future. I'm going to introduce the rest of the platform. This is Sarah Woolley from the Bakers Union. Bakers Union leading on so many fronts at this moment in time, both in terms of fighting the question of low pay and tackling the question of climate change. And Sarah put the motion to Congress today that was passed. Sarah will need to leave very shortly after she's spoken, so have a think if there are specific questions you want to put to Sarah before she leaves. And here we have Diana Holland. Diana is the Assistant General Secretary of UNITE. We're incredibly grateful for Diana coming along to contribute to tonight's discussion. She spoke earlier in the year at one of our conferences that we organised on climate refugees. Diana also, this is no slight on the meeting at all, does genuinely need to leave quite early, so again, have a think. I'm going to take questions to Sarah and Diana after they've spoken. And then finally, we've got Chris Boff, Assistant General Secretary of PCS. PCS have been in the lead on the question of climate jobs right from the very beginning, and we're looking forward to Chris's comments in today's meeting. So without any